Good morning friends, I welcome all of you to my lecture sessions on biochemistry for pharmacy students. So in this we have been discussing about the amino acid metabolism for the past three classes, amino acids and proteins. So in this lecture session we will discuss in detail about the metabolism of individual amino acids and their biological significance. So here we will see the significance of amino acids which produces pyruvic acid. Okay, so we have four important amino acids here: alanine, serine, glycine and threonine. So these are the four amino acids for which we are going to discuss in this lecture session. Okay, so let's go ahead and then see what exactly is there in it. The amino acids that are converted to pyruvate, so here as I have shown you, alanine gets directly converted to pyruvate by transamination. So serine by deamination, catalyzed by dehydratase, means dehydration also will happen. In case of glycine, by accepting one carbon, because glycine has only two carbons, so that's why it will accept one carbon and gives first serine, and then it will be converted to pyruvate. And threonine by splitting gives glycine, that may give serine. Okay, so it's a two-step process. Further, cysteine also gives pyruvate by deamination and desulfuration, and tryptophan, after transformation to kynurenine, it releases alanine, that will be converted to pyruvate. Okay, so regarding cysteine, we will discuss in the sulfur-containing amino acids, and tryptophan in aromatic amino acids. So that's why we'll discuss about these four amino acids in this lecture session. Okay, first let's see alanine. So alanine structure is relatively simple: CH3CHNH2COOH. It's a non-essential amino acid because it can be biosynthesized from pyruvic acid. It's a glucosinic amino acid. Okay, pyruvic acid gets converted to oxaloacetate, and oxaloacetate can enter into gluconeogenesis pathway. So that we have seen in the gluconeogenesis chapter. So here the key amino acid transferase, okay, so this is a simple amino group transferase reaction that is happening here. Alanine amino transferase, or ALT, is the enzyme which actually does this job of removing amino group from alanine. So in this process, because here you just see this word transferase, okay, so these enzymes transfer amino group from alpha keto amino acid onto alpha keto glutarate, so that glutamic acid is generated. From glutamic acid, glutamine dehydrogenase enzyme, glutamate dehydrogenase will create 2-keto glutarate again. Okay, so in this way alanine can be converted to pyruvate directly. Then it's a very important transporter of ammonia from muscle to liver. Okay, so ammonia is a very toxic chemical, highly water soluble, so it has to be shifted from tissues where it is generated in case of amino acid catabolism, and from there it has to be shifted to liver, where ammonia is excreted as urea. Okay, so here alanine is one form in which it is shifted. So pyruvic acid that is formed from glucose metabolism, okay, the pyruvate that is formed from glucose metabolism will be converted to alanine, okay, by taking up one ammonia molecule. So ammonia will then shift from skeletal muscle to liver. It will reach liver. Okay, so this is the way. So this actually ALT reaction, whatever I am showing you over here, is actually happening in liver. Okay, then So this is to summarize. So what exactly happens in case of alanine? So here you can see, in case of muscle, what exactly is happening? Glucose upon glycolysis, it is becoming pyruvate. So the pyruvate takes up amino ammonia that is obtained from alpha amino acids. Okay, so they will give ammonia, and then this ammonia will be utilized by synthesizing alanine. Now the alanine will be sent to liver, where alanine is converted to pyruvate by glutamic, alpha keto glutarate will be converted to glutamic acid. Okay, and then pyruvate will be converted to glucose via gluconeogenesis. Okay, so this is the entire process that is happening. So this is what we call it as pyruvate glucose cycle or alanine glucose cycle. In blood plasma, as much as 300 to 400 micromole per liter of alanine will be there, because alanine is one of the major transporter for ammonia in our system. It is a substrate for gluconeogenesis, as we have seen over here. In case of liver, it is actually helping us in the biosynthesis of glucose. Next one is serine. In case of serine, it looks very close to alanine. Okay, only difference is we have a hydroxy group attached to carbon over here. If we have CH3 here, it will become alanine. Okay, serine is a non-essential amino acid because it can be biosynthesized from alanine, or it can be biosynthesized from even glycine. It's a glucogenic amino acid, and it is biosynthesized from 3-phosphoglycerate naturally, because normally it is biosynthesized from 3-phosphoglycerate. 3-phosphoglycerate, from where we can get it? We can get 3-phosphoglycerate from glycolysis. Okay, in the glycolysis, in the first step of cleavage, okay, phosphoglycerate is obtained. Serine does not take part in transamination, okay, direct transamination. Transamination means it does not need any help from the other substrates. Like in case of alanine, alanine needs alpha keto glutarate to shift amino group from alanine to alpha keto glutarate to obtain glutamic acid. Okay, so here it can be directly deaminated. It happens in two steps. The first step is dehydration. So dehydration is resulting in an enamine. Okay, so the ene, ketoenol type of tautomerism, will give you this. This amine can be hydrolyzed, so thereby ammonia is released, and then pyruvate is generated. Okay, so in this way, serine can be directly deaminated with the facilitation from dehydration reaction. Okay, let's see here the detailed mechanism of how actually deamination is happening and how glycine is generated. So in the deamination reactions, usually pyridoxal phosphate is the substrate. Okay, it helps as a coenzyme to facilitate deamination reaction. The aldehyde group over here reacts with amino group, so that an aldimine is generated first. Then the enzyme, dehydratase enzyme, actually takes up this proton, which initiates a cascade of events. Okay, this electron pair is shifting to this, and this is shifting to this, and here a bond breaks over here as well as here. So here what is happening? The monocarbon unit HC double bond OH, formaldehyde is formed, and the remaining carbon units are attached to this one. Okay, then what happens? The proton is again coming back over here, so thereby you are having a saturated carbon over here. And now what is it that we have? N double bond C. If you hydrolyze this one, what you will get? You are going to get CH2NH2. So this is glycine. So if you don't want glycine, then it can take up another carbon unit, formaldehyde or otherwise monocarbon unit, that is supplied by monocarbon suppliers. Okay, like tetrahydrofolate. Okay, tetrahydrofolate containing CH2 will provide the monocarbon unit that we will see in detail in the coming slides. Okay, monocarbon metabolism is a very important process. So by accepting one carbon, so this substrate again can be converted to serine. Okay, so if we wanted glycine, it gets hydrolyzed so that glycine is uptime. So friends, this is the way how serine and glycine are connected to each other. Both serine as well as glycine are providers of monocarbon units, which will enter into single carbon metabolism process. Okay, so in our biochemical pathways, whenever and wherever we need to add a single carbon unit, like in case of methylations or formylation reactions, in all these single carbon transfer is happening. So there serine as well as glycine, they play a very very important role that we will see in the coming slides. So here ultimately what is happening, the serine is getting degraded to glycine and formaldehyde. So this monocarbon unit formaldehyde will be taken up by tetrahydrofolate. So NN methylene tetrahydrofolate is going to be formed. Okay, so there are three different kinds of changes can happen upon altering the chemistry of this monocarbon unit, so that it can become formyl group, CHOH group, or else CH3 also, CH2 and CH3. Okay, so all of them we will see in the coming slide. So this is the way how we are charging tetrahydrofolate with one carbon that can be utilized for monocarbon transfer reactions. Okay, the carbon is over here, the carbon whatever we have over here is now over here. Okay, so monocarbon transfer reactions like uracil can be converted to thymidylate. Okay, so in this way, because in case of nucleic acid biosynthesis also this plays a major role. Next, serine is a substantial source of one carbon groups. That means CH2OH group is readily transferred to tetrahydrofolate, and in our body so many biochemical synthesis are happening and cell production is a continuous process. So when a cell is to be regenerated, every part of the cell is to be regenerated, including its nuclear material. Its nuclear material includes thymidine. Okay, so uracil to thymidine shift. Okay, so that needs thymidylate synthase, uracil to T. Okay, here we have thymidylate synthase enzyme will be there, thymidine synthase enzyme will be there, that needs monocarbon unit. So that's the reason why there is substantial demand is also there for serine. Daily is demand will be there. Hence serine plays a very important role in our biochemistry. Okay, so biosynthesis of serine from glycine while charging folate to become hydroxymethyl folate is actually a reversible reaction, but it is always preferred to get glycine from serine, but not the either way, but not in the reverse way, because it is not advantageous as far as energy is concerned, because here we are losing a very important molecule, that is charged H4 folate, means tetrahydrofolate, which is an essential ingredient in the biosynthesis of thymidine from uracil. Okay, so thymidylate synthase is the enzyme for which one of substrate is uracil and coenzyme is tetrahydrofolate. As you all knew, cell regeneration or otherwise cellular formation of new cells is a regular process in our body. Okay, because our bone marrow generates daily millions of red blood cells. So when a new cell is formed, obviously it needs so many ingredients. Nuclear material is also a very important component in the cell. Hence, continuous requirement will be there for tetrahydrofolate charged with CH2OH are monocarbon unit. That's the reason why it is not advantageous for our system to obtain serine by expending a valuable resource like tetrahydrofolate, charged tetrahydrofolate, while we can get serine easily from food. So that's the reason why it is not considered as an advantageous biochemical reaction to obtain serine from glycine. Further, serine metabolism gives us a very important input, that is ethanolamine. So let's say if you decarbonylate serine over here, what is that remaining? OH, CH2, CH2, NH2. So this NH2 will be converted to ammonium ion like this. This molecule is what we call it as choline. Choline is a part of your very important signaling molecule, that is acetylcholine. Simple acetylation of this hydroxy group is going to give us acetylcholine, a very important neurotransmitter. Further, the choline unit is also a part of cell membrane biochemistry, phosphatidylcholine. Phosphatidylcholine is a very important ingredient in the manufacturing of or in the formation of cell membrane. Friends, so that's the reason why serine is a very important ingredient for in our biochemical processes. Demand for serine in the body are great. Both one carbon groups and substrates for synthesis of complex lipids have to be supplied from serine only. So that's the reason why synthesis of carbon skeleton from glucose is of great significance. Serine is obtained from 3-phosphoserine. That is obtained from 3-phosphopyruvate. So this 3-phosphopyruvate is obtained from 3-phosphoglycerate that is obtained from glucose via glycolysis. So that's why I told you that serine is a non-essential amino acid that can be biosynthesized. So that's the reason why serine is always obtained from glycolysis products. 3-phosphoglycerate. To give you a summary of whatever we have seen so far, the relations between various biochemical pathways, glycine and serine are connected. Serine, upon metabolism, it gives glycine and monocarbon unit, this one. And here, the monocarbon unit containing or charged folate can be used for methylation reactions or carbon transfer reactions. Serine, upon elimination of amino group, it is converted to pyruvate. Then, serine is biosynthesized from glucose, because glucose gets converted to 3-phosphoglycerate upon glycolysis, and then 3-phosphoglycerate will be converted to 3-phosphopyruvate, hydroxypyruvate, and then to 3-phosphoserine, which upon hydrolysis it gives us serine. So here serine is a very important ingredient, phosphatidyl serines, phosphatidyl ethanolamines, which are a part of lipids, and then serine is converted to choline, and then phosphatidyl cholines are synthesized, acetyl choline is synthesized, and choline is incorporated into special lipids, we call them as sphingomyelins, which are there in your nervous system. So serine, with the help of palmitoyl coenzyme A, it is converted to sphingosine. Sphingosine is converted to sphingomyelin, is integrated into sphingomyelin biosynthesis. So very important special kind of lipids that you will find in the nerve tissues. So friends, this is the way how the biochemistry or metabolism of serine and glycine significantly contributes to our biochemical processes. Next one is glycine. Let's see glycine alone. It's a non-essential amino acids, because it can be obtained from various biochemical pathways like metabolism of serine. It is a glucogenic amino acid. It is biosynthesized from serine and it can also be obtained from carbon dioxide, ammonia and C1 group supplied from charged tetrahydrofolate. Okay, so this is the reaction which we have seen just now. The glycine and monocarbon charged folate gives us serine and folate, or else serine can be metabolized to give us charged folate and glycine. Transamination of glycine with pyruvate gives us a very important molecule, that's what we call it as glyoxylate, okay, and alanine. As well as oxidative deamination of glycine also gives, okay, glyoxylate molecule. So this kind of a biochemical reaction happens in peroxisomes, and oxalate is going to be formed at the end. Oxalate is a toxic chemical, so when oxalate concentration increases, it gives crystals. Okay, oxalate crystals are can be formed. Glyoxylate cycle predominates in plants, not in human beings. Okay, the major pathway of glycine catabolism is oxidative cleavage of glycine in mitochondria. So glycine gets degraded to carbon dioxide and ammonia while transferring this carbon unit onto folic acid. Okay, so here methylene, it's not CH2OH, it is methylene, CH2, is shifted onto folate. The reaction is reversible and catalyzed by glycine synthase enzyme. But as you can see, carbon dioxide and ammonia are supposed to react with each other, because in urea cycle, you might have seen this one. Okay, carbon dioxide gets converted to carbonic acid first, which needs one ATP, and then this reacts with ammonia to give us carbamoyl phosphate. Okay, so which needs another ATP, and then here two ATPs are consumed, so one more ATP will be consumed while transfer of the methylene group from folate to this carbamoyl group. So this entire thing needs 3 moles of ATP. So that's why it is highly endergonic reaction. Hence it is not completely favored. Okay, so we can get glycine directly from serine metabolism. Molecules of glycine is a substrate required for the synthesis of several very important compounds. Okay, because all these you will see in the coming lectures, especially nucleic acids, porphyrins of hemoproteins like hemoglobin, phosphocreatine of skeletal muscles, and tripeptide glutathione also contains glycine. Okay, so that's the reason why glycine is a very very important molecule. As you have, you might have already seen in case of protein biosynthesis, okay, protein biosynthesis, especially enzymes. So we have seen this type of structures. Okay, so in enzymes you will see loop regions as well as the helical regions. Helical regions contain largely heavily substituted amino acids like phenylalanine, arginine, etc., whereas the loop regions are enriched with glycine. Okay, so glycine adds flexibility to protein structure. So this is the way how glycine is contributing to our biochemistry. Now let's summarize. So now serine is going to give us glycine. This is one of the resource. The second resource is from carbon dioxide and ammonia and one mole of methylene loaded folate can give us glycine. Okay, so now glycine can react with pyruvate to give us glyoxylate, which will result in formation of oxalates. Okay, so that is a toxic reaction as far as our biochemistry is concerned. And glycine is used for the biosynthesis of creatinine purines, porphyrins, glutathione and glycine conjugates. Okay, glycine conjugates. So this you will see in the biosynthesis of bile acids as well as aromatic acids like hippuric acid, and also drug metabolism. So these are what we call them as phase 2 metabolic reactions where conjugations happen. Because glycine is a highly polar amino acid, by when we have NH2 group, CH2 group, COOH is there. Let's say so in case of amino acids, we'll have amino group will be there and COOH group will also be there. Let's say in case of a drug molecule, if we have a hydroxy group, then this hydroxy group will be esterified with this carboxylic acid so that its polarity can be increased. Or else if it has some kind of COOH group over here, this will be amidated with this NH2 group, so that in this way the conjugations increase polarity of drug. And here also bile acids polarity will increase upon conjugation with glycine. Okay, so glycine conjugation mechanism is a very important mechanism in our phase 2 metabolic processes. Now let's see threonine. Threonine is a essential amino acid. It is very closely related to the amino acids that we had just now seen. Just to give you a very simple idea, this is a framework we have for glycine. And if you add one more carbon, it is becoming alanine. And if you have one hydroxy group over here, it is becoming serine. And if you have one more carbon over here, this is becoming threonine. Okay, it is becoming threonine. So in this way, all these amino acids are related to one another. It's an essential amino acid and it cannot be synthesized in our system. Further, it does not undergo transamination reaction. Okay, so it is actually biosynthesized in plants and microbes from aspartic acid via threonine synthase enzyme. Okay, threonine synthase enzyme. It is a glucogenic amino acid where it will be degraded to glycine, so that glycine is participating in glucogenesis. The next one is it will be converted to succinyl coenzyme A, and the succinyl coenzyme A will enter into glucogenesis, and it will also give us propionyl CoA by oxidative decarbonylation, so thereby it participates in the gluconeogenesis. Okay, so this is the way. It is also ketogenic because propionyl CoA gets degraded to give us acetyl CoA, so that will give us acetoacetyl CoA, which is a very important ingredient in the ketone bodies. Okay, here let's see this. See, threonine is over here. It can be converted to 2-MnO3-oxobutyrate because the OH group gets oxidized, so that it then be degraded to give us acetyl CoA and then glycine. Glycine is also coming. Or else you can cleave it to give acetaldehyde and glycine. So in both the ways, glycine can be biosynthesized from threonine. Then if you add here folate, okay, CH2OH, that is loaded folate over here to give us serine. Serine can get converted to pyruvate. Okay, that we have seen in the previous slides. The alternative pathway is the direct deamination of threonine by dehydration. Okay, similar to what we have seen in case of serine, dehydration mediated deamination reaction happens to give us 2-ketobutyrate. Okay, so this reaction we have seen just now. I'll give you a little bit of idea. When you dehydrate first, what you will have? C double bond C NH2, okay, COOH H3. Then because this is an enamine, it can be converted to NCOOH NH2CH2CH3. Okay, now it will be hydrolyzed so that here you will have C double bond. Now 2 keto butyrate can be obtained. This 2 keto butyrate, because this is an alpha keto carboxylic acid, coenzyme A can be biosynthesized from this because decarbonylation is a so this compound is a high energy compound. Okay, because two carbonyl groups are side by side, that will give you propionyl coenzyme A that can be converted to succinyl coenzyme because CH3 gets oxidized. Okay, so this is the way how succinyl coenzyme A can be obtained, propionyl coenzyme A can also be obtained. So they can participate in gluconeogenesis. So the succinyl CoA can become fumaric acid, then malic acid, and that will become oxaloacetate, that will enter into gluconeogenesis. Okay, so friends, to summarize, glycine, alanine, serine, threonine, upon metabolism they'll give us they'll give us carbon frameworks that can be submitted to gluconeogenesis, and these, especially serine, can provide us methyl single carbon unit containing compounds which can be loaded onto tetrahydrofolate. Among all these four, threonine is an essential amino acid and all the remaining are non-essential amino acids. I hope you understood the metabolism of all these four amino acids. If you have any doubt or otherwise if any concept is not clear, please post your concerns in the comment box so that I'll clarify them. And I'll see you again with another very interesting lecture on amino acid metabolism soon. Thank you.